G'day guys, welcome back to our channel, Star Wars Vault Unleashed. My name is Terrence Lofty and I'm your host, coming straight here from our studio in Sydney, Australia. Today, episode 24, I am so excited to introduce you to one of our collector, a special guest. His name is Daniel Uthman from Portland, Oregon. He is actually the first collector that we're going to be interviewing from Oregon. So welcome to the show, Daniel. How are you going?
Thank you so much for having me. I'm really honored.
Hey, Daniel, really appreciate your time. The fact that it is, it's almost sleeping time over there.
Yeah. I don't know how far apart we are in hours, but you'd think we'd be closer together, but you're a day ahead of me, I think. So, yeah.
That's correct. Yes, it is. So once again, really appreciate your time and staying up for this interview. And I can't wait for our audience to see your collection there. So, Daniel, can you introduce us, tell us a bit more about you?
So I am married with two children, ages 11 and 4, and we live in Portland, Oregon, as you said. I work for a company called The Athletic that it's a subscription-based sports media company that's based in the United States, Canada, and the United Kingdom, and Europe, and hopefully coming your way soon. We'll see. Business is pretty good, so
good.
We need to get a little cricket coverage, I think, would be helpful. And I oversee our coverage of the National Football League. But honestly, my greatest interest and my greatest desire to spend my time is here in my collection and, scouring Facebook and everywhere else and local shops, because we do have a good number of suppliers here for the best in Star Wars, old and new in some cases.
That's really awesome. Hey, Daniel, so the fact that, one of your passion is, of course, spending time in your room for Star Wars. How did you get into Star Wars, first of all? And of course, how did you get into collecting?
So Star Wars, A New Hope, or as we just called it, Star Wars at the time, came out when I was 4 years old. And obviously we all know the famous story. There weren't any toys available at the time. The theater where I saw it was not even a mile from my house, straight up the road. I think the first time I went to the movies there was to see Snoopy come home. And right. The second one was, I think, Star Wars. So, it was amazing. It was captivating. No one had seen anything like it. Certainly not a four-year-old. And then, a Christmas went by and, I was playing with like Fisher Price Adventure People and, little Tykes toys probably. Right. So when the early bird kit came out, that was like, I had no clue. But by the time the 78 came around, I was in kindergarten, you have friends, you have Christmas catalogs, and you realize, like, these things exist. So for Christmas 1978, I think I asked for an X-Wing, and I got three figures. I got an Obi-Wan Kenobi, an R2-D2, and a C-3PO. That was Christmas 1978. And I got Legos and some other things, share with my sister and stuff. But because, I was a bratty five-year-old at that point, I really wanted Luke Skywalker, right? He was the hero. He had the lightsaber.
Of course.
So I remember being a little bit of a grumpy ingrate on Christmas Day when I got, I got Ben as the sliding saber too, right? But he's like this old man. I loved R2-D2 with the clicking head and the shiny dome.
Yeah.
C-3PO was cool too. It was shiny. He had no accessories. So, I was always kind of an accessory hog even then. But I really wanted Luke Skywalker. So the next day in my hometown, it was a snowy day, and I don't remember why, but there was no malls where I lived then. There was like a walking mall downtown with like a five and dime store. But my next door neighbor was the manager of that store. And they had mostly rack toys, like not not a lot of like brand name. There wasn't a lot of Mattel and Ideal or anything there. But we went downtown and they had this window display from like knee high to like 10, 12, 16 feet tall. And it was a like rectangular, vertical rectangle of Star Wars figures in the window on pegs.
Wow.
Like imagine just like, you know, 8 by 12, like 96 figures, all repeated. There's only 12 at a time, right? This was even before the 20 backs, I think.
Yeah.
They just had this window display, you know, of like this grid of like 96 figures. And so we go to the store manager and they, you know, my parents know what I want because I've been complaining probably. And I was like, do you have a Luke Skywalker? And he goes, no, those are all sold out. Then I looked at the whole grid and there was one Luke Skywalker at the very top row, which was like, you know, you needed a 12-foot ladder to reach it. So I said, no, wait, there's one. So my next door neighbor, Mr. Goodyear was his name, he actually had to go get a ladder. The store manager had to go get a ladder because this bratty kid was out there outside the front door in the snow, like, because he spotted that one he wanted. So anyway, that was how I got my Luke. And then, I think for Empire Strikes Back, the snow speeder came out and I saw that it had this light function and noise. And that was the one I was really obsessed with. And I got a few more figures then. But it was interesting because like after that, as a child, my collection was all like ephemera, like bookmarks, the trivia book, portfolios and notebooks, you know, spiral bound notebooks. And those Return of the Jedi pens or pencils that I'll show you with the little pellet leads. Like after Empire, all of my Star Wars collecting was ephemera. And then I got into G.I. Joe and I stayed in Lego and other toys like that. But it was really probably 2008, I think, when I turned it back on. And then ever since then, it's just been ramping up and ramping up and ramping up. So, yeah.
That's really awesome. Wow. So you mentioned, you know, your sort of like first five figures. I mean, the first three being Obi-Wan Kenobi, C-3PO, R2-D2, then you mentioned Luke Skywalker as well as the X-Wing. Now, you still have those in possession.
I have the snowspeeder from my childhood, but I don't have, like, all my figures. Somehow my parents got rid of them, I think when I was in college probably, because I kept them in, like, this, there was, like, Rubbermaid was this company that made all kinds of products in the U.S. and storage things. And I kept all my figures in this, like, I don't even know how you would describe it. It was almost like a file box. And Boba Fett was in there and Yoda with his, like, all his accessories. I loved Yoda. Like, that figure blew my mind. Like, I'd never seen anything like it. I really like the small figures for some reason, like R2-D2, Yoda. I like the Ugnaught. I love Wicket. I don't know why that is, but that's where I kept them. And then at some point they disappeared.
Yeah.
So I have my snowspeeder, but the rest are probably in a landfill somewhere. But they've been replaced.
You know, of course. So
And I'll talk to you when it goes through my collection. I'll tell you a little bit about sort of a quest I completed this year that ties back to all that.
That's awesome. And also just make sure that you say, you show us that childhood X-Wing that you, that you've had since you're a kid. Okay, Daniel. The fact that you kind of regained your passion towards collecting Star Wars in 2008. So you've haven't obviously stopped until now. But at any point in time that you wanted to ever give up collecting since then?
No, I mean, my wife would love me to, but no, like, you know, I have a good amount of G.I. Joe, most tied to childhood or the things I really was passionate about. Right. And I can show you that too, if you like. I've always had, like, I have all my childhood Legos. It's a fraction of what my kids have. and my son is 4 and my daughter's 11, and like, yeah, they have way more than I ever had, but I have what I had, you know, yeah, for those. But I've always sort of collected something, had different passions. For a while, I was collecting Playmobil and realized that, like, even though Playmobil figures are much smaller than Star Wars figures, mm-hmm, what they come with is so much more massive.
Yeah.
So from a family agreement and conflict issue, like, I had to get rid of some of this girth, like, in taking up all this space. And Legos are a little bit like that too, but they're right, at least a little bit smaller, and you can put them in bins and out of sight, out of mind. But Star Wars is manageable. And I'll tell you, like, this is about, a lot of this is about the display and the collection. And I use my collection space as kind of like the confining, the limiting factor on my collection. So if it can't fit in my actual visual display or in the storage underneath, because that's how we built it, then I have to buy and sell and exchange, you know? So, you know, it keeps me from going crazy, you know?
Absolutely. So. Awesome. All right. Yeah. Well, Daniel, without further ado, I can't wait for the audience to see what you've got over there. Come on, let's get straight into it.
Okay. All right. Cool. All right. One sec. Let's just start with the originals, I would say. Let's start with A New Hope. So this is like the first shelf of the first 12. You can see there. Yeah, there's a couple. This back here is a transparency that I got from Tracy Hamilton, who's a very much beloved collector in the US. And that's the Starfield. And then this is a 8x10 print of that transparency, which I just think is like so iconic, and you know, it goes to the very beginning. So here are the figures of the first 12. Actually, I don't have a big head Han in my collection, believe it or not. But then you can see the carded ones back there too. And I'll just scroll through that. So as you notice, like, there's a Ben, there's a C-3PO, there's an R2, my first three. Mm-hmm. That's my Luke. And that Luke was the last carded figure that I didn't have that represented a figure I had as a kid. So I had 8 of them as a child.
Right.
I had the 3 I got for that Christmas. And then I had the Luke the next day on December 26, 1978. And then in 1980, I got a Yoda for a birthday. I got a Bespin Luke at a Safeway grocery store. I think I got a Boba Fett at the same grocery store. And then for Christmas, my grandmother, along with that snowspeeder, I really wanted a Han Solo because he was such a swashbuckling, like, charismatic figure, you know?
Yeah.
And so I really wanted a Han Solo, and my grandmother got me the Han Hoth, which was like great. But I was like, no, I wanted the one with the vest. Like, again, I'm like terrible. I was so greedy and such an ingrate, right? So now I do have a kind of a very teeny weeny focus on Han Hoth now. But so I appreciate him. And then here's another Star Wars shelf. These over here you've probably seen before, but these were serial premiums. Sort of punch out vehicles. There's a X-Wing, a Land Speeder. There's a Millennium Falcon there. You know, I love the catalog, so I have some catalogs here too. This is a Roy Frankenfield photo transparency of the Sandcrawler playset, or the Jaw playset. And then these are some Japanese stickers that are just really cool. I have a friend in town, Billy Galaxy, who everybody knows, who has amazing Japanese Star Wars artifacts.
Wow.
You can go in there any day of the week and see something made in Japan that you had no idea existed. And Billy has just like so much knowledge. So it's really kind of hard to resist. And then I'll go down here, and here's some more. Here's like a little section. I try to do some Kenner stuff and just some random things. This is a transparency. It's a little bit hot, the light is, but That's a transparency of all the 12-inch figures. There's some Kenner materials. There's a Dewey Shoemate business card. I love that. I'm also obsessed with like ways to display things. So I spend a lot of time on the internet finding ways to preserve and hold things.
Yeah.
And that's like a 3-inch by 4-inch acrylic magnetic thing that's like five bucks, and I can't get enough of them. So there's like an alternative Luke brown hair. There's a gray haired Obi-Wan Kenobi. Here's some other ephemera. I'll show you this. This is another Japanese thing. That's a bento box there on the right with the yellow and green. Really cool. And then I love, I don't know whether it's the Helvetica font or whatever, but I love the Letraset stuff. Hard to find, really expensive. But when I can find it and it's in good condition sealed, like I try to grab it. It's, I don't have a lot of it, but I just think it looks really cool, you know? And I'll just pull back up here. Again, like, as I said, like there's a little mix of modern and vintage with me. So
the whole excited, like, there.
Yeah, I love those, the modern three packs. You know, I'm never going to be able to afford a vintage three pack, but the modern ones do look good. And so, you know, I kind of love the Cantina, and, you know, they came out with a lot of different, they came out with so many Cantina characters in the modern version that I'd love for them, you know, if they had done the vintage, but they won't. But anyway, I just thought it was like kind of a fun display. So yeah, that's what that is. Yeah, yeah. So let's move on to The Empire Strikes Back. This is certainly the movie that, like, I remember seeing the most, you know, like, by that point I was 7 years old or whatever. So anyway, this was a lunchbox that I had as a kid. You know, again, like, as I said, I didn't have a lot of the toys. I had a good amount of the ephemera. And that lunchbox, I just stared at. Like, I love that picture of Luke with his blaster out, you know, there in the swamp and everything. You know, here's a prototype micro with a more production version of it, you know, of Luke with the saber. This here, I see if I can hold it up for you to see.
Oh yeah, I can see that.
Yeah, that's a Luke card art slide, you know, image. And then again, there's a couple of moderns in there. These are those 6-inch that came out last year, but it's Dagobah. So like, that's, I keep it as a theme. There's that beautiful art on that board game. That board game is so gorgeous.
That's awesome. Yeah.
And that's still in its original shrink wrap. It's hard to see a little bit here, but this is transparency of the Luke figure, and it has I have another place I'll show you before the end of the tour that you can get a really good look at it, but he has like essentially like a broomstick for a saber in that picture, which is really cool. And then here's some vintage figures, you know, the blonde and the brown, with that Yoda that I just love. And then we'll come down here to this shelf. And again, like, there's Han Hoth in the background, Boba Fett, which was one of the 8 I had, and then Yoda, which was another one of the 8 I had as a kid. And then a few more here. I love 2-1-B. I don't know what it is. I think it's partly like the transparent guts, you know, abs.
Yeah.
I just love that. I also love the green in his bubble, you know, it's just so cool. I really like that Leia card too. That's not the best condition mock there, but I was like, my toy store as a kid, I was in a small town, and the toy stores that we went to, we had to drive 2 hours to get to, and Best Products was mainly that toy store. Right. There were a lot of Best Product stores in Virginia and in the Midwest and everything. But I have a large collection of Best Products catalogs going from like 75 to like 86.
Awesome.
And, you know, the glory years. So anytime I see a Best Products like price sticker,
you know, I'm going to grab it. So here's another like a internal photo of the Collect All 32 display, which is really cool. Jerry James on Facebook had that, and we're kind of pals and do some exchanging and stuff. So, and then here's, you know, the Empire figures, like sort of like what the Bespin group, I would guess you would say. And there's that quiz book. I just like that quiz book. Yeah. I have like incredible nostalgia for. I still probably wouldn't be great at it, you know, if I opened it right now, but great nostalgia for that. Then we'll come down here to this next shelf, and I'll sort of do a pullback here for you. So this is, as you'll see, like I really love the transparencies, and I have a decent number of them. Not like I'm not complete on any certain part of the transparency collection, but like I just like nice samples, right? Like
yeah, that and Cloud Car pilot. The fact that you kind of display it that way, you know, it's just the colors is just so striking. It's awesome.
Yeah. So what I use is I take this, I take a piece of vellum, you know, like that plastic paper stuff, and I just cut it and I put it into like a cylindrical shape. Well, I'll just show you. So like it's essentially a votive, right?
Wow.
It's a puck light, it's a remote controlled puck light from the hardware store. And this is the remote I use. That's what it looks like. And you know, runs on a watch battery, and you sort of set it and forget it.
There you go, so, folks. If you're into transparencies, that's one way to do it. Great advice there.
Exactly.
Yeah. Thanks, Daniel.
So, and the nice thing is that transparency envelopes from Kim Simmons or Kenner or wherever, they have a it's not transparent, translucent. They have a translucent backing, so they automatically diffuse the light. Sometimes you have to get, you know, cut a piece of plastic out and slap it in there, you know, behind it or something, but it just works. So anyway, here's some more carded figures behind them, you know, from that Empire era. I don't know what it is about the Cloud Car pilot, but he's kind of underrated and super cool. And I love IG-88 too. You know, here's all the bounty hunters sprayed out here. And then this shelf down here, couple more transparencies. Yeah, this is all Hoth kind of, and Dengar's hanging out in Hoth, I guess. but I like to like create play scenes if I have the room. And you know, so that's what that is. And there's a placemat back there. You know, there's a Rebel commander. That's a prototype of him. This one's a little bit hard to see, but like, you know, you've got the kid's hand in there. That's right. You know, just really fun. You know, just really kind of a fun transparency. It's a little bit hard to see with the camera, but So that's that one, and then we'll just try to pull you back a little bit so you can kind of see the whole thing there. So and let's go look at Return of the Jedi and some Last 17 here. One of my big interests is I grew up playing in the woods. So Endor kind of means a lot. I mean, look, Hoth is awesome, and everything about Hoth is so cool. And we would get snow growing up, but we were really in the woods a lot.
Right.
So Hoth, I mean, so Endor is something I really sort of gravitate to, even though it's one of the more earthen planets you're going to get, obviously. Anyway, here's just a good sort of array of things. That's a Kim Simmons photo up there of, you know, the mock-up of the Ewok village. And this one, this 8x10 here is a Toy Fair catalog image. A lot of the transparencies, some of them are from the back of were used on the back of action figure cards, and some were used in Toy Fair catalogs or planetary maps or something, and some were used as box art that I have. So here's one. I'll try to show you this one. If you can see that, that's like a test of a boy a little boy trying trying out the Scout Walker.
Yes.
So, yeah, like so.
Hey, Daniel, cool with your collection, or I guess your passion towards the transparencies, where do you source that from? And was there any help from the communities at all?
So the Dealer Don't Deal group on Facebook is a major source of it. And then people just tend to notice, like transparencies, I don't think there's like a major like market for them. It's not right. Like if you post like a 31 back Boba Fett, 20,000 people want it, right? But there's not as big of a market for transparency, I don't think. So I think that sometimes if people see like, oh, he really likes transparencies, I've got this thing sitting around that doesn't really fit me, like, or my collection or focus, like someone might say, like, you might enjoy this more than I do. Mm. And odds are I probably will. So that's really sort of how it's sort of evolved is, you know, it's really sort of a strong interest of mine. I just like, you know, it goes back to the whole lights and sounds thing, you know, with Kenner Star Wars, you know, that gives you the lights, you know? Mm. So anyway, here's a mix of Return of the Jedi and Last 17 figures. This shelf is more of like the space in outer space part of Return of the Jedi, you know?
Yeah.
With this selection of folks, people that are piloting things or that are, you know, on Death Star 2 or something like that. You know, that kind of grouping. Yeah. And then some of these figures back here, there was a guy locally in town who had come upon this find of like every Jedi in Empire Strikes Back figure. And the Jedi ones in particular were like in incredible condition for what you normally see. Like that B-Wing pilot back there, like that bubble is almost totally clear. And so he just had this major find, and he runs a shop. He was trying to flip them and sell them, and he was selling them for like really great prices, like $85, $95. Wow. You know, that squid head was like $85, I think. So it's like, jeez. Man, like this is great, you know? Ooh. So, you know, and so anyway, I was like, I can't resist that. You know what I mean? So, this Akbar right here is one I just got from Ryan Lemkool, and it's a molded arms Akbar. I love any of the figures that have like the molded features, like that Rebel Commando right there is a molded face Rebel Commando. Like, you know, I don't have a molded legs Hun Hoth, but I'd love to find one. You know, there's a molded face Maydeen right there.
Okay.
So yeah. It's pretty cool. And then, of course, like, here's another Return of the Jedi shelf, and this is, like, the back to Tatooine, Jabba's Palace, you know, desert, whatever. That's sort of, like, this is very crowded, like, I will say, you know, because there's a lot of Jedi product tied to that. But, you know, I try to keep things together and organized. This is another one. This is, I just knocked over 8D8. This is a slide of that Boba Fett card art, you know, the Jedi card. So pretty fun. And then this one's a bit of a mess. I keep working on this one. This is
the Ewoks, I can see.
Yes, it's just stuff. I mean, it's just, I got to do something about this. I might have to clear space somewhere else, but like, you know, it's just stuff stacked on stuff, you know. You know, there's a lot of Ewoks in there. And this is, I don't know if you know Mike Freeman in Fourth Moon Toys, but he had some of these Vacform stickers. They are really cool. There's a whole series of them, and I only have that one. The Gamorrean Guard's not that hard to find, but some of the others are, but really, really cool. Here's some more of that ephemera. You know, the erasers, the stamps, the magnets, you know, it's just cool. Pencil toppers. There's a coin purse back there, you know. Here's another slide. If I can, well, hold on, my thumb's in the way. Sorry, folks. That was sloppy on my part.
Okay.
Here's a slide of a Kenner store display.
Oh, wow.
If you can see that.
Yeah, pretty neat. That was from Sean Lemkool. He had all these amazing Kenner slides, and you know, I can't resist certain things. there's a few of them around, but anyway. So then we'll slide over here. Oh, and then I was saying about those Jedi pencils that were like mechanical pencils. Oh man, I have great nostalgia for that. I snapped a lot of those back in the day. But yeah. So
hey Daniel, just before just while you're sharing that pencil, this is something from my childhood as well.
Oh yes, yes.
I love it.
Hang on a second.
What you got?
There's
the same
one in there somewhere. Man, I've got so one. Hold on, hold on.
Oh, there you go. I can see it.
I can't believe I'm finding this. Look at that.
That is so cool.
Isn't that funny? So I'll take you over here to some more indoor. That one's a little, there's a little bit of glare on there. I might have to pull that out and show you a better version. But that's from a Toy Fair catalog. You can see like the writing. I don't know if you can see the writing very well.
Yes, we can.
On the instructions, please return to Simmons Photography, East 6th Street, Cincinnati, Ohio, phone number. This is the only transparency left is what it says. I mean, I love that, awesome. You know? So here is a, here's a mock-up box art of that mock-up Ewok Village, which is really cool. And then here's a planetary map. That Ewok Village I've had for a really long time, and it was just sitting in storage forever because I'm like, where am I going to be able to fit this thing in? And it like just fits this space, like just barely. So I was glad to finally, after many years, be able to pull that out. So anyway, here's this is not my snow speeder box as a kid, but it's the one that I had, you know, I had the pink version. So this is just like sort of a random hodgepodge of Hoth stuff. You know, there's the laser cannon. There's this Princess Leia window, you know, the light catcher thing, you know, you melt the beads into the little shapes. And I'm sure if I put it in the oven, it would just be a total disaster, but you know, it's in its original shrink wrap and everything. You know, so here's some more of those micros. I think those, I got those at Celebration. You know, they're just really cool when they're unpainted like that. There's a baggy Luke right there. Nice condition. Yep. This is one that took me a while. I don't even remember when I made this. It's been quite a few years.
Oh, wow. But, that's super cool.
Yeah. This is a custom Lego. You know, this the sets inside, like that far wall is an old Lego set. And then this was an old Lego set. And the land speeder, I mean, the snow speeder is a Lego set. But like the platform it's on, I'm not going to try it now because I'll probably break it. But it's like on a hydraulic lift that I'm not very good at Lego, but I was like, I can figure out some way to move this lever and lift it up and, you know, whatever. And then this little like transport vehicle, I was like, well, it kind of looked like it floated in the movie. So maybe I could like hide the wheels. I don't know. I'm like, I know it's really dorky, but, and then like,
I made that's really this, awesome for you to put this together.
Yeah. So I made these, I wanted the blast doors to open and shut. So I figured out a way to put like a dial on it, you know, to do that. You know, again, like if we ever move from this house, I don't know how I'm going to transport that, but I'll enjoy it while I have it. So, and then here's some more transparencies. These are all, you know, this is, well, I'll tell you a thing. So like you can see back there, there's the AT-ATs.
Oh, wow. That's super cool.
Yeah. I mean, it's one of my favorites. It's just amazing. Exactly. And it's amazing. Fine as well. I'll try to get in there. Like, it's so sharp. Like, obviously, like, it has to be because they projected that onto a much larger size. The photography is just amazing, you know? Same with this one here. Like, it's so sharp. But the reason I have, like, you're like, wow, like, this survival kit thing. But another collector, Brock Walker, was like, hey, like, I know you have the AT-AT from Hoth. I have the transparency that was used on the box when they added the survival kit to it.
Right.
So he's like, would you be interested? And I was like, absolutely. So that's where that came from. So anyway, it's kind of cool. And then here are a couple early Han Solo Haas. Well, this is the early one here with like those alternative painted boots, you know. And then this back here, it's hard to see, but that was one of the original things I got. It's a slide. That's a Kim Simmons slide of an alternative snow speeder box front. So anyway. I probably shouldn't have that, Luke, because that's like a 2020 figure right there, that retro from the board game. But I'm like, yeah, you know, it's 5 POA, and you know, there's a real, exactly. There's a real one in there, you know. So you know, I'm still honoring it, but
Is that the and this still theater, works. You've had since you were a kid?
Yes. Yes.
Wow.
Exactly. Let me balance myself so I don't like break anything, but
there you go. It's still working.
Yeah, there you get a little light, right? You can see it. Sounds like it was just made yesterday, right? You know, as we know, like the Mandalorian's very popular and you know, I've dabbled in that a little bit. You know, this is very cool stuff. I try to like limit that just because it does eat up a lot of space, but it is really, really cool. And then here, you know, this is all things from the sequel trilogy, but I really love the modern versions of 5 points of articulation figures because like the ones we grew up with, the vintage ones, they're like some of the most durable toys ever made. Like how can all these millions and millions of figures still be, you know, in the public domain and in you know, prize condition for even now. So, you know, one of the reasons I like these, and I'm really sad they never made them for the Rise of Skywalker, frankly, but like, I just think like these are really high quality toys. So, and there's some, you know, there's some crew items here. Not a crew used, but that was from Pinewood, from the Creature Effects. And, you know, here are some, stickers they tend to make to sort of like celebrate and build camaraderie and morale and everything. Yeah. So let me take you back over to this other side. Pan through here.
Wow. I mean, seeing the room just like that in a flash is amazing.
Yeah. So I'll take you through this pretty quickly. This is, again, like, as I said, I love Endor and the Ewoks. So I'll just sort of pan here and you can see there's some loose figures across the bottom there. I think those are some of the best modern figures ever made. But you know, that I love that cute Wicket up there. There's a Lily Letty, that short mouth biker scout up there. There's an Ewoks press kit from when they were introducing them for Return of the Jedi that's complete and really cool. There's that security scout, which is kind of a hard to find vehicle and is kind of very odd design, but very cool. And then I just love that Wicket. Like, Wicket's one of my favorites. So, and again, like, it wouldn't be a case if I didn't have more slides to show. So, again, oh, here we go. There we go. So there's another box of the Ewok Village and everything. And then, again, here's some modern 5 point of articulation figures. This shelf is just a total mishmash of ephemera. There's this awesome design toothbrushes. These, I don't know if people have seen, but like they're these die-cast Japanese figures. They're very heavy. They're only like 3 or 4 inches tall, but they're super heavy and super well made. Super 7 was importing those in the US. And then I really like watches, and here's like a pretty wide variety of like classic. It's definitely not complete, but there's some unique ones. Like you don't see that carded LCD very often in that form, that Darth Vader watch. I just bought that from Mike Freeman and Fourth Moon Toys. So yeah. And again, more Lego. Those, nice. I didn't make those up myself, but like, again, like when they're going to go that hardcore on indoor in the Ewok Village, I can't really pass it up. So anyway, like sort of the final part of my display is, you know, obviously, again, more transparencies. These are Toy Fair catalog images. So cool. Those two on the flanks were pre-Toy Fair 1983, those images. Just really, really amazing. You know, a lot of Empire figures and introducing all those new Return of the Jedi figures. Here's a mix of modern and vintage back at Jabba's Palace, you know. And then here's a pretty heavy loaded transparency area, you know, of Toy Fair and card back images, etc. These are some Ewoks figures card backs. That's from a Toy Fair catalog. This is the box image of their Jedi Falcon, which again is one of these. There's a glare in there, but the sharpness of that image, the detail, like you know, you can see the Wookiee fur, you can see the shine and every detail and every button on R2. There's the box art. It's another. I'm sorry to say the glare is bad, but yeah. There's the box art for the Endor Jedi AT-AT. And this is a Nelvana like promotional transparency from the cartoon, which is kind of fun. But yeah, so there's a Droids logo. There's an Ewoks logo. This was from a Hakes auction. I know some other people in the community have similar versions, but you can actually see on here like the engineered setup of how he was able to line up the figures and stand them up. Like he screws in these rods and boards and everything, like, you know, and obviously there's a bunch of unproduced figures here. Like those are just, you know, unproduced Droids and Ewoks are really, really cool. So, yeah. And then again, like my other, like maybe my biggest passion in Star Wars is just the work of Ralph McQuarrie.
Of course.
And so this is sort of a shrine, I guess, maybe, I don't know. But there's like these old, you know, these were from these science fiction movies. These are photos that were distributed to the media, you know, back in the 70s and 80s. These are internal Hasbro images, like of those McQuarrie prototype Power of the Force 2, or Power of the Jedi, I think, vehicles from back in the day. And this is a Ralph McQuarrie designed robot that was made in Japan. It's like a clock, which is just kind of crazy.
That's
but really, really cool. Yeah. You know, this is one of my definite prized possessions. I'd always dreamed of having a McQuarrie original art piece. And for Father's Day this year, my wife surprised me with this. It's an Ewok horse concept. Wow. So you can kind of see like there's some Ewoks there and just really kind of a beautiful pencil drawing by the man himself. So I'll show a few more. Like this is yet another one of those transparencies that it's not the most beautiful image, obviously, but it shows you like that just beyond the screen backstory, like how this work was done, right? You know, there's this, you know, there's these, you know, blinds in the background and a vacuum hose, and if you look closely, like there's another carded figure just sitting on top, you know. So you know, anything that sort of shows behind the scenes is really cool. And I've got another one here grab same venue, and that same vacuum hose, and this is an unproduced, you know, Ewok series mock-up box of, you know, if they had re-released the village for in the Ewoks line, like that's what it would have looked like, right? Or could have looked like, you know. And then the last two
These are from the carrying cape. You've seen this many times. So there's one of them. And then these came from the guys at Collector Investment Brokerage, you know, down in Georgia, the Atlanta area. So there was one, and then here was the other.
Super awesome.
Yeah, pretty cool, huh? Pretty cool.
There's something about the vintage ones that are just so, you know, when you put the toys side by side, it's just so striking, isn't it? It's just wanna,
yeah.
You just want to play with it. You just want to, I don't know, you just don't want to touch it even. Wow. Daniel, thank you so much for taking us through your Star Wars room and collection there. It's just so amazing the fact that you kind of put them into, you know, based on location sets. You got the Hoth, the Goba, the, you know, Endor, especially your passion for Endor. It's just amazing.
Yeah, it's, I don't know what it is, like I said, I grew up in the woods, so, you know, it translates, I guess.
And of course, your transparencies collection. My gosh, I've never seen anybody actually collect so much of those transparencies. It's amazing. Thank you for sharing.
Yep, thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
Of course. Hey, Daniel, let's jump into the rapid question, shall we?
Mm-hmm, sure.
Okay. Do you think Star Wars collecting is an addiction?
I don't like to think of it that way, but I will say that when you start having things dropped off at the house like every other day, and then when you go without it, you feel a withdrawal.
Yeah.
I think that might be emblematic of an addiction. So yeah, conclude what you weigh there.
Sure. And, you know, when you talk about when, you know, that the, you know, certain items coming through your door, right, your doorway, right, that
mm-hmm.
bell rings, you know what was coming.
Yeah.
But the question is, have you ever hid any purchases from your wife?
At times. Not these days, but certainly at times, yes.
Right.
I might go to the door pretty quickly just to check and see what it is, you know. And the thing is, I will say, like, this display is a confined space. So even though what's showing up is, like, precious to me, there's nothing massive showing up that's going to, sure. like, set off alarms, right?
Yeah.
So.
That's awesome. What would you consider is the most valuable piece in your collection? Or perhaps I should say, you know, have you ever received a present that is meaningful to you?
So this would not be like monetarily the most valuable to anybody, but my snow speeder would be that because, you know, A, I thought it was an amazing vehicle in the movie, right? They were super fast and
right.
super gnarly, and they got a lot of screen time, frankly. Took that an AT-AT. But the reason I would say that for myself is, so in 1980, my great aunt and my grandmother went with my parents and my sister and I to Florida. So my parents surprised us with a trip to Disney World. And I think I just turned 8 years old, and, my grandfather had passed away in 1979, and my grandmother and great aunt had decided to start spending their winters in Florida because that's where their brothers and sisters they grew up with and in the rural parts of North Carolina all went. So, they said, we're going to Florida for a couple weeks. We're going to go to Disney World. We're going to go here. We went to the Tupperware World Headquarters randomly enough. You know, that's where you go when you're with grandma.
Hey, it's plastic. What's wrong with that?
Right. I know, right? Exactly. Should have been right in my veins. But, you know, like Disney World's a big trip. That's a present into itself. But of course, like I said, like I was greedy. I like toys. So I was wondering, like, am I going to get any presents for Christmas? And so there weren't a lot of presents that Christmas because Disney World and that trip was a huge present. But on Christmas morning, we were staying in this little like motel and you know, I got to open, you know, somehow this present, I certainly believed in Santa at the time, but I got to open this present and I had asked for the snow speeder because I knew it had the lights and the sounds. And I ripped it open and it was that snow speeder. And so that was like my big, one of my only presents, but definitely like my most desired present that year. And you know, it still works. The lights still work. They still make the noise, you know, so.
That's an awesome story. That's great, Daniel. And on the flip side, you know, what's that one thing that you haven't got in possession or in your bucket list?
Well, so 2020, I definitely crossed off a lot of things. Like, I didn't have the Luke from my childhood or the Boba Fett, and I got both of those. And then the amazing shock was just, like, my bucket list thing forever was, I just want to have a piece of Macquarie art before I die, right? And then my wife just surprised me. So in terms of, like, bucket lists, this is a little weird because it's not actually vintage. But I really would love to find some prototype material from when Hasbro released the Macquarie line, you know, in the 30th anniversary. It was 2007. They did that Macquarie line. Any pre-production related to that is like sort of like my next bucket list item. Like, there's always gonna be a bucket list item. That never stops. But exactly. You know, anything related to Macquarie and that specifically would be really, really awesome because they didn't have, you know, everything was a Macquarie figure sort of in the old days, you know, but those designs, those preliminary designs that he had come up with and the characters and how Han Solo looked or how Darth Vader looked or how Luke looked or Starkiller or whatever. So so that would probably, I would say that would probably be the one, even though that's probably an unusual answer because it's not true vintage, you know, so.
Yeah, well, there you go, folks. If you do have any of those, pre-production Ralph Macquarie figures, get in touch with Daniel.
Yeah, I'm right here.
Daniel, thank you so much once again for taking us through your room and your collection there. My gosh, I am so impressed and I'm sure our audience are as well. So really appreciate it, Daniel.
Thank you so much. It's really been fun and I'm glad to share it. I really like showing people like what I have and seeing what they have too. So all these shows are really, really great.
Folks, if you haven't yet subscribed to our channel, please do so down below. And if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and check us out on Instagram and Facebook as well. I look forward to catching up with you all on episode 25, where we're going to meet a collector outside of the United States, where we're going to go to Sweden. So we're going to first interview a European collector. Can't wait for that. So once again, Daniel, thank you so much. And may the force be with you. And to all of you, may the force be with you.